retirement. And so, you know, for the last couple of years, I come together.
I would like to welcome everybody tonight to the College of Complexness.
I'm going to have the, stuff into an avocado, my usual.
Doing the videography for tonight. Andy Anderson will be our moderator. And tonight we have Dr. Laura Chamberlain talking about Clean Count Cook County. From Clean Count Cook County and our elections vulnerable to hacking and what we can do about it. The College of Complexness has been meeting weekly since 1951 and consists of the following format. We have a brief announcements period, then we have our speaker who speaks. We then have a question and answer period. It is a question, and then at the end of the question and answer period, you'll have our infamous rebuttal period where you'll get to speak on or off any of the topic tonight, which usually is the most entertaining part. And usually the most, usually the one part that has the most, what I call MBFP or whatever it's called.
MBFP?
Yes, we'll get into that.
MFB, isn't it? MFB.
Yes, I think so.
MFB.
MFB.
B.
MFPB.
Most effing BU.
No, male bovine fecal matter.
Oh, yeah, okay.
That's MBPF, never mind. Anyway, we have quite a few people who can generate quite a bit of that around here.
Yes, that's for sure.
I just like to take a brief reminder of the rules tonight, and that is one, no personal attacks.
Boo.
And then second, one fool at a time.
Yeah, okay.
Okay? And that means devil's advocate. No, that means it includes Charlie, who sometimes teases that. Go ahead, and then he'll introduce you.
Oh, thank you.
So this is your book, right?
Yeah.
Dr. Laura Chamberlain is going to tell us about election theft, vote theft tonight, and I've talked about this book myself, about the red shift, how computers are used to shift the total to the red zone after we go to bed to keep Republican criminals in office after they have lost the election. This is one of the very best books you can buy to understand that. It's called Code Red, Computerized Election Theft by Jonathan D. Simon. So I hope that, I assume Dr. Laura will give us a very, very in-depth analysis of what's in that book and the whole Republican red shift. It's never a blue shift, it's always red shift.
We'll talk about that.
All right, yay.
Welcome
Dr. Laura.
Please have for Dr. Laura.
Thank you, everyone.
Hey, Victor.
I have a little thing here. Happy birthday, Henry.
Yeah, that's
happy birthday, Henry.
That to us, Jonathan. Just go ahead and set it aside.
Okay, good enough. Okay. My name is Dr. Laura Chamberlain, and
my name is Laura Chamberlain.
Great. And I am working presently with a group called Clean Count Cook County, and it's a coalition between my group, which is Who's Counting Chicago, and you can call find us on Facebook. So Who's Counting Chicago, and Illinois Ballot Integrity, and then some other community members as well. So Clean Count Cook County is a working group. And we formed because Cook County and Chicago are going to get a whole new election system this year. Their machines, the touchscreen machines, the optical scans, they're breaking down.
Yes.
And so they are going to purchase a whole new election system. And we're going to get in there. This is, I don't know about this one, sweetheart. Do you want me to just hold it? I can walk around then. That'd be great. I like that.
Well, you may.
There's the right way and the wrong
way. He probably just be on for you, though.
Hi. Okay, great. Excellent. Okay, I'm going to come out from this.
Thanks.
So we want to affect the purchase, what they're going to purchase, and we're going to also, we want to try to affect the systems, the election systems. And that is Chicago and Cook County. And the Chicago and Cook County together represent the third largest election jurisdiction in the country. So LA County is first, and then New York, and then Chicago. So it'll be very, very important what comes out of Chicago. There's a lot of innovative stuff going on in different parts around the country, and Chicago, we hope, will be right in there. And I'm here talking to you because I want people to volunteer and to come into our group, especially if you are IT or have any, you know, experience with computers at all. We definitely need people that have experience with that, because a lot of what goes on with the counting of our votes has to do with computers and, you know, math, and, you know, it doesn't have to be complex, but they're making it very complex. You can find Who's Counting? In Chicago on Facebook, and you can message us there. This working group, we do not have a Facebook or a website or anything like that yet. Okay, I wanted to talk about, are the Russians hacking our elections? Or have they hacked our elections, right? This is one of the big questions in Washington, D.C. right now. And when they talk about hacking our elections, there was no evidence whatsoever that the Russians or anybody externally hacked in an organized way the actual elections, the votes across America in November. There was no evidence of that. Some external, organized, massive, you know, hack across the U.S. There is a lot of evidence of election fraud. So there's a lot of hacking going on, but there's no evidence that the Russians were doing that. What they did do, possibly, is hack into the DNC. And they also, there's also a question about a couple other things as well. But so when Washington talks about that, they're talking about the DNC hack and who gave all those emails and Podesta emails, Hillary emails and Podesta emails, and Democratic Party emails to WikiLeaks. That's what they're really talking about. It definitely has sparked a debate about the security of our voting systems. Yeah.
What DNC mean?
Yeah, Democratic National Committee.
Oh, Democratic. Okay.
Democratic National Committee.
I'm not too political.
Right. That's okay. That's okay. The Democratic National Committee. They were the ones that were hacked. Clinton's emails, Podesta's emails, other staffers with the Democratic National Committee. So it sparked a debate about the security of the U.S. voting systems. And it even got the Department of Homeland Security involved in the past election. And I'll talk to you about that. Congress seems less worried about the hackers breaking into our actual vote counting system than the political issue. Large-scale, widespread external hacks of the U.S. elections are extremely difficult. We have nearly 10,000 election jurisdictions around the country, in 50 states and all of those territories in Washington, D.C. It is really, really hard for some kind of organized, massive external hack of our actual vote counting systems. Election officials in counties, towns, districts, and territories run the elections. It is highly decentralized. None are networked, okay? So Cook County isn't networked directly with DuPage County, okay? Or any of the other counties. And most are not connected directly to the internet until they start reporting the results, okay? It definitely makes it harder for the hackers. There's dozens of different types of voting systems across America that are utilized. 80% of Americans vote on paper ballots, but what counts it, whether it's a machine count or a hand count, there's very little hand counting going on in America. Most of them are electronic voting, electronic counting machines. The U.S. officials and Democratic Party have accused Russia of a spate of cyber attacks in recent months, and including the DNC, but also in Guccifer 2.0, they think he may have been Russian-tied as well, okay, if you followed the leaks, the WikiLeaks. But also, let me continue that in a second. The intelligence assessment refrained from accusing Russia directly interfering with our state election systems, but they said that some U.S. states have experienced some possible intrusions for voter data, okay? In Illinois, this is false. I just got off the phone yesterday with the State Board of Election, and it is false. the hack of the Illinois State Voter Database. How many people knew that the Illinois State Voter Database got hacked in July 2016 before the election? Okay, they did. And Arizona got hacked as well. And there were other intrusions into state voter systems. In fact, the Department of Homeland Security intruded into several states, including Georgia. So we didn't really know what was going on in the summer. We were very, very suspicious of all this, all these intrusions. This this was brought up at this in the Senate Judiciary Subcommittee this past week about the Russian interference in our elections. Were these hacks? Okay. So what it was, and this is from the State Board of Elections, the Chief Legal Counsel of the State Board of Elections. The it was a hack. Whoops. One second. It was a hack of our Illinois voter database. I'm going to go forward just a second because, yeah, right here, 90,000. What they did was the hackers broke in and they got the data from 90,000 voters. No voters were erased from the system. But their driver's license numbers, their not their social security numbers, but their driver's license and their state ID numbers were obtained, and then their names and their addresses. And the State Board of Elections found it out immediately, closed the hole within one day, and took down the whole system. So no voters lost their registration, their voter registration, but some of this information got into the hands of a hacker. The CIA and the DHS and the FBI are told the Illinois State Board of Elections that they thought it was the Russians when it happened. This was in July 2016, before the elections. They told them that they thought it was the Russians, but they have not, there's no lick of proof about this. The same hacker got into Arizona as well. So it was a little bit of an organized hack, but there's no evidence that it is the Russians. And they never came back to the Illinois State Board of Elections with any proof that it was the Russians. So as of now, at least at the state level, they don't believe that it was any Russian hacking. They found a hole in the database, and they just went in and started downloading information, and it was closed off within one day. And so when you hear in the Senate Judiciary Committee that the Russians have hacked the state's election systems, don't believe it. There's no proof of it yet. And they never got back with the Illinois State Board of Elections officials saying that it was the Russians or saying it was anybody. What they did was, what the Department of Homeland Security did, was they came in and they reviewed their system, they recommended some more security, they added another layer of security at the state voter database, and then they put it back up. The state says that they get hacked all the time. The State Board of Elections says their website gets hacked all the time, and they are constantly upgrading the security. They are successful at blocking these hacks, so they're attacked. How many people here are computer geeks?
No.
Okay, so what is the name of it when you're attacked but you're blocked because of some security mechanism?
Firewall.
A firewall? Okay.
Firewall.
So they're attacked a lot, but they have appropriate firewalls. And this was the first time that they actually had...
they hacked the firewall.
Yeah, they hacked the firewall. So this has caused a really consternation around the world. Did you guys catch the Dutch elections this past week?
Yes.
Okay, they scrapped all of their machines and they voted on paper and they counted by hand, right? Yeah, exactly. We're getting there.
That's what Trump want to do, right?
Trump does not want us to vote on paper and count by hand. I guarantee you. He does not want us to do that.
That's why the right guy wants it.
Because if we do that, we will have a Democratic Congress in 2018.
The right-wing guy didn't get it.
So, no. Trump does not want us to do that. So, but anyways, the Dutch definitely counted by hand. I have a call out to the Dutch election officials to see how that went, because they hadn't counted by hand. I wanted to see. And they brought it up very quickly. Within 2 months, they scrapped their machine, and they got paper ballots out, and they counted by hand. So I want to see how they did.
So results won't be final until next Tuesday.
And we know, everybody know the result of the Dutch election?
Did
you guys pay attention?
Next Tuesday, the results are coming out. That's when they're certified.
They're not certified yet. Yeah, exactly. But so far, it looks like the right-wing Trump guy did not get enough seats to control the government.
Trump guy.
So,
France is next, right?
Okay, so that's the Russian hack. And I really want you to just understand that it is just the Russian hack of the DNC. That it is, my understanding from everything that I read, that many people hacked the Democratic National Committee. Many people did. And lots of people were hacking Podesta, because his password was password, right? So everybody and his brother was hacking Podesta. So I think there was probably a lot of leaks coming out of the Democratic National Committee. But it's got this nice big conversation going, and what is the best way to secure our elections so that nobody can hack in? I wanted to proceed with the state. I want to talk about the state, and then we're kind of come back into the local level. The state and local voter databases, they are constantly trying to clean them up. They want to get dead people off the rolls. They want to get people who've moved out of Chicago, moved out of Illinois. They want to get these people off the rolls because they're sending mail to you and all sorts of stuff, right? And there's been a lot of talk about cross-check. How many people here know what cross-check is? Great, excellent, 1, 2, okay. So Greg Pallas is talking about this. Cross-check is, it's a database of citizens that are duplicated from state to state. Okay, so it's a database of a bunch of citizens where their name appears on several state voter registration lists. Okay, so James Jones is a really, really common name, right? James Jones probably is on every single state database in the country, and probably many James Jones. So it is simply just a list of duplicate names. James Jones is in Illinois, and James Jones is in Arkansas as well, okay? It's owned by a Kansas elected official, Kobach is his name. It was started by him. And the problem with this is that many states are using this database to clear up their voter database. If James Jones lives in Arkansas and also in Illinois, then they're going to try to get James Jones off the voter database in those two states. It only includes the first name and the last name, and I believe date of birth. That's it. They don't include middle name. They don't include surnames like junior or senior. And it's really caused a lot of problems. But it's been hyped a little bit. Greg Pallas is out there saying that millions of people were purged from the voter rolls because of cross-check. And that actually is not true. It's not true in at least Michigan. I know the states that I've verified that it's not true, Michigan and in Illinois, and it's probably not true in several other states too. So Illinois it's free. Cross-check is free, okay? The Republicans want people dumped from the voter rolls. So Kobach is a Republican from Kansas. He put this list together. He wants lots of people dumped from the voter rolls.
Why would they even need cross-check? You could go to a company right now called Axicom, AXICOM. They got all the consumer database you could ever want to double check data rolls, and it's cheap.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. Well, Eric is a response to that. This is free. The Republicans put it out for free, and about 26, 30 states, chomped on. Oh, free data. Great, excellent. Okay. Just Illinois received 420,000 potential matches in 2016 from cross-check. But that does not mean that they were purged from the rolls at all, because Illinois has a long process to get you purged from the rolls. Other states, it's not so long. That's the problem, is other states, okay? ERIC is another database that 20 states have come together, and they're sharing information from their Secretary of States. Who lives here? What's their name? What's their middle name? What's their surname? What's their date of birth? There's Social Security. Is anybody dead? They're sharing the death rolls, okay? And they're sharing this information, and they've developed their own system. And we are a member of ERIC as well. That costs us about $50,000 a year. And ERIC is a far more reliable information. Illinois is still a member of both, because some of the states in CrossCheck are not in ERIC as well. So just so you know. But here's the process that they have to go through. If they get some names, like let's say James Jones is on the list, and Illinois is looking at James Jones here in Cook County, and they think maybe he lives in Kansas as well, okay? And what they do is they send him a letter, they send James Jones a letter here in Illinois, and if it gets returned back undeliverable, so the person is not at that address, it's the wrong address, then that voter goes on an inactive list. And he still can come in and vote, but what would happen is he would have to sign an affidavit at the polling place, saying that he still lives at his address, I'm still going to vote, and he is not purged from the system, from the rolls. He's not taken off the rolls. He's got to be inactive for 3 federal elections before they take him off the rolls. So there's a long time for James Jones to come in and vote and prove that he still lives at his address. And he still would be considered registered to vote. All he has to do is just show up, sign the affidavit, and he's registered to vote. So this is what's happening with this. This was another really big thing that was talked about before the November elections, that CrossCheck was going to purge from the rolls millions of people. And it may have happened in other states, but at least in the states that I've checked, it has not. There's processes to keep that from happening. What I'm outlining for you is all of the vulnerabilities of our system, okay? I'm going through how they are vulnerable. Because if somebody wanted to, they could get into these systems, if a hacker wanted to, and they could start posting up some data, right? Some people's names to get them thrown off the rolls. But at least in Illinois and Michigan, they're not going to be thrown off the rolls. The transmission. People talk to me all the time. How are these votes being transmitted to the jurisdictions, right? On election day, you vote in a polling place, and they run all these paper ballots through the machines, or you're voting on a machine, and somehow these numbers get transmitted to the central office of the election jurisdiction. So it is a secure cellular transmission with encryption and password. So how many people here know what that is? Great, excellent. Tim, you need to come with us. Okay, because I really actually don't know whether this is hackable or not.
Yes, it is.
It is hackable, but it's kind of hard to do.
Okay. And then some of them transmit via modem with encryption and password. But this, we don't know if our election material, our election results that are transmitted from the polling place. And in Cook County, we have 4,000, almost 4,000 approximately, precincts around Cook County that are transmitting vote totals on election night to central offices.
So what's so hard about that?
Yeah, it's just that it seems to me that we might be vulnerable there, right? No. Yeah, he's nodding yes.
Depends on what level of encryption they're using, and it depends a lot on I'm sure they got some things in there.
Yeah, they do. I do believe that they have some things in there, especially after this past summer, okay? It seems to me that all of the election board, the boards, are really ramping up their computer security since last summer. So, across Illinois, most of the precincts transmit the vote counts by hard data. It's delivered. Okay, and then here in Cook County, we are doing this. We're remotely transmitting via secure cellular transmission with encryption, and some of them are transmitting via modem. This is for all of Illinois, okay? All of the votes in Illinois. Okay, now I'm coming down to Cook County. So I kind of outlined the vulnerabilities of our state system. And now I'm going to come down into the Cook County. Attacks can come from outside the election jurisdiction, like hackers or political operatives, but also from within the election jurisdiction. So employees within David Orr's office, the suburban Cook County clerk's office, and for Chicago, the Board of Elections. So that I just want in, outside and inside. We went through in our group and we looked at all the different vote ways we can vote here in Cook County, and we started to kind of rip it apart, like how many ways can they steal this chicken, right? If somebody wanted to steal the chicken. And I'm going to ask right now, I want people to raise your hand and I'm going to call on you and you're going to tell me who you think might be interested in stealing the elections, changing the vote counts in Chicago. Anybody got any ideas? Yeah, go back. Go ahead.
Bruce Rauner,
exactly.
The mayor and my alderman.
Bingo, that's exactly right.
The Cook County Democratic Organization.
The Cook County Democratic years. Organization, exactly.
Well, I'll tell you, you know, everybody just wanted to fool around, want to mess around with it.
Some people just want to mess around with it. It's possible. Like somebody just play it.
Yeah, there are
sure.
So many teenagers.
Sure, teenagers. Yeah, lots of teenagers are happy. Absolutely. Absolutely. All the political structures in Cook County and in the state have something to say with our elections. Madigan even has a lot to say about our elections here in Cook County. I don't know if you know this, but the Chicago Board of Elections is pretty much managed by Madigan, Speaker Madigan. He gets to pick. The Chicago Board of Elections is an unelected board. There's three people, and it's appointed. They're appointed, and they're appointed by Tim Evans, the head of the circuit court. And Tim Evans does what Madigan wants. And we know it for a fact, because we got Dick Simpson. Last year, at about this time, there were two openings on the Chicago board. And we got Dick Simpson to throw his hat into the ring for one of the positions on the Chicago board. How many people know who Dick Simpson is?
He's a political science professor.
Right, he's a political science professor. He was an alderman. He's written books on elections. He had a 35-page resume just on elections, okay? So we got Dick Simpson to throw his hat in the ring here, and he was facing off a couple political hacks. And one of the political hacks that got named to the board, Jonathan Swain, was a zoning appeals lawyer. He's a zoning appeals lawyer. He had no experience with elections at all, not one little bit, but he did have one thing in his application package that Dick Simpson did not, and it was a letter of recommendation from Madigan. He was the only one that had a letter of recommendation from Madigan, and he was the one that got chosen.
Is that legal, miss? Is that legal?
Totally, because we do not have an elected Chicago Board of Elections. It's appointed, and it's by state law. So we need to change the laws here in Cook County, you guys. Not only do we need an elected school board, but we need an elected Board of Elections. We need to be able to determine who's running our elections. And right now, it's definitely Madigan and his henchmen. So here in Cook County, now that's just for Chicago. That's just for Chicago. David Orr is an elected clerk, and he runs the elections for suburban Cook County. Okay? So we have early voting. We have early voting in Chicago. I'm going to talk about Chicago, but I think people that are coming from the suburbs can extrapolate out from there. Early voting starts a month before the elections, month before the election day, and you can vote anywhere in the city. There are 52 early voting sites. If you live anywhere, you can vote anywhere. It is a nightmare for campaigns, because if you can imagine, let's say you are running as an alderman in one ward, you have to have your campaign staff out for an entire month at 52 sites every day, you know, and watch for your voters, right? To see who's showing up. That's what campaigns do. They watch and see who's showing up. And they are, a lot of the eyes on our election are about campaigns. Well, I tell you, I show up to the early voting sites and there are no candidates there. There are no campaigns. No campaign, not even presidential campaigns, have the staff to cover this level of elections across the country or across the city. So these election officials that are running the early voting really can do whatever they want because nobody's watching. I encourage you to really remember that. All votes and early voting are on hackable electronic machines. The machines can and have, they've been programmed to print up what the voter voted and count something different. But they also, we get plenty of reports of people going in and pressing buttons for a candidate and another candidate show up on the screen. Then they have to go to another machine and press buttons and, you know, see what happens. We call them push and pray. Push and pray. So we want to get rid of the electronic machines, and we are definitely on our way to doing that, and I'm going to tell you why. So the electronic voting machines are the ones where it's a screen, and you're touching a screen, it's a touch screen, and it's counting the votes. You're pressing in your choices, and it's counting the votes internally. We can't see it. It goes on a little thumb drive, and that's that. And there's a little paper toilet roll on the side that hardly anybody looks at, and that is what they call a paper trail. And I'll talk about that too. So early voting. The count is completely centralized. Those little, all of the hard drives on these machines are taken to the central office and they're counted. No observation, no proof that the data sticks can't be altered, no proof that there's any security of the data sticks. It's very bad. Well, they put the data sticks in a little plastic bag and they put it in a blue cart at night. They leave all of the equipment out at the early voting sites for weeks. I had a poll watching training at an early voting site, and the blue carts were there, and all of the machines were packed up, but they were there. They were all spread out around the room. I was training. It was in a library. And the librarian never came up at all. We could have altered all sorts of stuff in that room, and they would have never known it. And that was just one site. So it's not secure. The early voting goes on too long. It definitely limits the observation of citizens and candidates. The vote totals for early voting are merged on election day, so you can never see, did Rob win by 50 points on early voting and lose by 50 points on election day? Like, there's no comparison. You can't really compare it. Okay. All of the votes go to a central tabulator where there are basically six computer guys that you cannot observe, you cannot have meaningful observation of these guys, and they could be running algorithms and using fraction magic, and we would never know it. And then they say, oh, don't worry, you have audits. You have audits. So how many people here know that we're suing the Chicago Board of Elections for unlawful audits, starting in the Democratic primary?
Exactly.
The Democratic primary last year at this time, and then the lawsuit continues for the general election too. And I want to I want to get to this video. How do I? Yeah, okay. So let me just set it up for a second. We took a bunch of people into the audits where they actually count the votes off of some of those 5% of the precincts. They take the paper ballots, they run them through another machine, but they unroll those toilet paper rolls from 5% of the early voting machines, and they read off the votes by hand, by one by one, and they tally them by hand. That's the audit. And we took a bunch of people in there to watch this audit, okay? And what we saw was really frightening. So I'd like to show you this video. This is Lee Camp. He's a comedian, and he picked up on this because there was a lot of talk about election fraud starting in, you want me to stop?
What is Russian television doing
okay.
up there?
There was a lot of talk about yeah. election fraud in the primaries.
What is Russian television doing up there?
That Lee Camp is on, his show is on Russian television. So it's redacted tonight. He's an American comedian. Let me finish.
It's a government-sponsored television.
Lee Camp is an American comedian.
Russian government sponsors.
Russian television American.
Yeah, it's a Russian television American. Okay. It's just a video.
Paid for by the Russian government.
I'm in this. The Russians have never paid me, okay? It is just a comedian that picked up. Okay. Can I please talk? Thank you. Stop being so. We put out a video that was done by the Chicago Board of Elections of a meeting where we came and presented to them all of the fraud that we saw when we were monitoring the audits. That video went viral, and Lee Camp picked it up and put it on his show. Okay? That's what happened. He never called me about this. He put it up on his comedy show. So that's what, it's just nicely edited. So that's why I'm showing it. I could show you a 30-minute video from the Chicago Board of Elections, but trust me, you'd be asleep by the end of it. Okay, great.
I'm going to show you mind-blowing video of how the voting machines were rigged in Chicago and possibly many other cities. And I realize this is like the third show recently where I've talked about how the primaries are being stolen, but this is the theft of our democracy. It's not like this is the third week I've covered how cucumber water is great for nipple perkiness in men. Then you'd be like, Jesus, he's going a bit over with the cucumber. Was he bought off by Big Cucumber? This is terrible. But this week, I have video from the Chicago Board of Elections that brings into question everything we've seen in these primaries. In Illinois, it's mandatory that they recheck 5% of the vote to see if the machines are operating correctly. And people can go and witness this audit. They can watch as the machines are tested. And you know, Saturday night's free, so you go to the UFC fight or voting machine audit. If you want to get laid, you go to the audit. Yeah. So here is what those witnesses saw.
Essentially, in the audit, they were erasing votes that the electronic voting machine paper record indicated had been cast.
So the hand tally shows that Bernie Sanders had gotten 223 votes and that Hillary Clinton had gotten 46 less votes. The hand tally showed that.
Okay.
But to meet the official recommended results, they had to literally erase Bernie Sanders' votes and add Hillary Clinton's. That's approximately 70 votes, 70 times about 500 active machines in the field, and there's more that we have documented here. It is a lot of votes.
What they're describing is election fraud. Person after person walked up to that podium and said the machines got the votes wrong, and the auditors covered it up. And I'm sure the Chicago Board of Elections officials and people at those little tables were horrified at what they heard.
Now, that's not really the way we do an audit. I don't think that that's really a credible way of believing that we've got a fair tally.
Can I just ask you, because are you
Have you done audits before, or are you just...
I participated in other elections. I have not done audits before, but it comes after in political science.
Okay. You're saying that this isn't the way to do an audit, and I don't, just didn't know whether you had any experience previously.
F*** you, lady! No, she's not a trained auditor, but you don't have to be to know the numbers shouldn't be changed to match what the stupid machines say. I'm not a basketball player, but I know when I see a basketball game, okay? If I saw two people rubbing their faces in a bowl of clam chowder and I said, that's not a basketball game, would you respond, are you a professional NBA ref? Then shut up. The Board of Elections was just presented with full frontal election fraud, and their response was, you don't know. I'm not a professional sex worker either, but I know when we're getting
apologize if you've got a little miscommunication or whatever, there was, you know, some difficulty here. And I will see to it, I will make it a point to spend more time during the 5% audit out at the warehouse after the November election to make sure that there are any difficulties that are resolved immediately and we don't have to go into this.
You apologize if there was a miscommunication? Yeah, the miscommunication was that you were just told the election was not legit, and you responded with the same urgency as if you were told your shower isn't draining so well. Oh, okay, I'll look into that. I'll put that on a list here and file it under S for shut your f***ing face. Look, these people, it's not like their job is to monitor elections and then also to collect the city's garbage and then to deal with the parking meters. They got to deal with they have one job. They have one job. So when they're told the audit was utter bullshit, their response should be, hold on, all of the machines? God damn it! We got to do this whole election over. God! That should be the response, not this.
The misunderstanding as to how things are required to be conducted. Sometimes there are issues that need to be addressed, and we welcome your criticism and your observations.
Aw, do you welcome our observations? Our little observations and whimsical musings like we're Jerry Seinfeld. Have you ever noticed? We live in a false democracy with the illusion of choice. What is that?
Which will take any dirt that they can and publicize. It's not incredible.
This is how corporate tyranny works.
That's all I'm saying.
Understood.
That's all.
Okay, it does go on from there, but that's the main evidence, okay? So what really happened was these audits that go on in Chicago and Cook County, they're like 5 days worth down at the warehouse. They run like 26 tables. There's two or three employees at each table, and they take the paper ballots, and they run the paper ballots through another machine. And we asked to, and we had dozens and dozens of volunteers there that have not trained auditors, but very smart people, okay? And we asked if they would just put the paper ballots through so that we could do a real quick hand count. We didn't want to slow them down. Just flip them over and put them through. No, they weren't going to do that. They were going to flip them through so they couldn't count the votes. And we were focused on the presidential race, okay, the Republican and the Democratic primary. So that was our first indication that something was up. The whole 5 days was just total freaking cover-up. So no, they are not counting our votes correctly, you guys. And when they started unrolling 5% of the early voting machines, and there's about 500 early voting machines that are deployed during the election process, okay? About, so 5% of those, they take the big paper trail off of those machines and they unroll them and they literally count them by hand. They say, you know, Hillary got a vote, Trump got a vote, and they have, they're making hashtags, okay, of these votes. So one person is the caller and one person is the hashtag. And what they did was on the tally sheet that they were making their marks, they had the recommended results from the Board of Elections right on the side. So what every single table did, all of them, was, let's say Bernie got 100 votes on that one tally sheet, okay? They would count out how many marks they had to make to get to 100, and they put a little dot there before they even started counting. They put a little dot there. And they started counting off the votes. And then they would, and they did this for all the races, okay? Hillary, let's say 150, boom, they put a dot there where that, where they would have to end their tallies. And when they got to those dots, they simply stopped counting the votes. They would just roll past them. Or they had, a couple of the other tables had another strategy. They would put their little hash marks, not on the tally sheet, but on little post-it notes, and then they would crumple them up and throw them away. Or they had, there were several strategies on how to rig an audit, okay? And in all of them, every single table had a strategy on how to rig the audit. So they came in with 100% correct hand count according to the Board of Elections. What the Board of Elections wanted them to see on that roll is exactly what they got. Now I want you to know that since we've been doing the audits in Chicago, since 2012 we've been doing these audits, the Chicago Board of Elections has reported zero errors to the State Board of Elections every year. They are perfect. Now we know why they're perfect. They're just making it up, okay? On the one table that I was watching, when they got to the end of the tally, they, their strategy was they were doing it in pencil. So they would mark all the votes that they read on the paper, but at the end of it, they just erased. So let's say Bernie, it says Bernie got 100, and they wrote down that they had read 126 votes for Bernie. They literally erased the 26 till they got to the 100. And it, let's say it said 150 votes for Hillary, but they only read 120. They just added the rest of them at the end of the audit. So that it would be perfect, perfect, according to what the Board of Elections wanted them.
That's what you're suing for?
Yeah. That's it's good. An unlawful audit.
You want us to testify on your behalf or something?
Afterwards, let's talk. Let's talk.
You got enough evidence, right?
Right. Oh, yeah. We're in court. We've been in court. They've been. We've survived many motions to dismiss, and finally, on March 30th, we're going to go to a hearing. But this has been one whole year. Okay.
What could happen?
So let me keep telling you. Do you have a quick question?
Why is any of this shocking you?
I'm not shocked. I'm just trying to tell you the story. Okay?
I mean, you know, it's why is that a shock?
What is shocking? What is shocking?
Let's hold the question.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to just keep going. What is shocking is how hard they've been fighting us, okay? And that is, so we brought them, this video that you saw, that was the Board of Elections meeting where they certified the results for the primaries, okay? And we stood up before that and we said, we want to object. And they said, no, shut up, sit down. Public comments come after the certification. So we couldn't object, although we did say stuff, okay? They wouldn't slow down. They certified the results, okay? And then they heard, person after person come up and testify how their audit was completely fraudulent. And they didn't do shit. But we did. We filed suit, okay? And then what they did to cover their tracks, because they knew they were caught, was that they hired an auditing firm and they wanted to get recommendations to make their audits better, okay? More efficient and more reliable. So for the November election, this was for the primaries last March, for the November election, this this auditing firm came in with every recommendation that we said. Take away the cheat sheet. Don't put the numbers that they're supposed to, you know, obtain on the side of the tally sheet. Take that away. Make everybody work in pencil and not pen, or pen. Make them work in pen and not pencil. Have the supervisors going around. Check it to make sure that they are, you know, actually reading every single vote, okay? So then we had the November election and we went back into the audit. We all went back into the audit. And instead of 5 days, it ran 11 days. And this time, they had 2,200 races that weren't reconcilable. They could not count those votes correctly for 2,200. So the Board of Elections went from zero errors, time after time, to 2,200. And they just literally, at the end of 11 days, packed it up and said that we can't do it, okay? Because suburban Cook County, David Orr's office, had a similar hard time. These paper toilet rolls are harder to count than you think. They are really hard to count. They're not separated like a ballot, you know, where the race is. You can miss them really easy. They smudge. It's very hard to figure out, you know, they have machines now where you can put these paper toilet rolls through them so that the counters can at least stay on track, okay? But the Board of Elections doesn't have them. So anyways, and this was after three attempts. Some of those paper toilet rolls, which were huge, like 400 votes, they were counted three times, and they still didn't get it right. So the Board of Elections is so pissed at us. We cost them a fortune. That the audit in November to cost a lot of money, certainly doubled or tripled the cost of this audit, okay? And I had people pretty high up in the Chicago Board of Elections said, okay, well, this is the death of the touchscreen machines, that's for sure. So. How many people here are happy that we probably won't have touchscreen machines in Cook County ever again? Woo! Exactly.
Depends on the replacement.
I know, totally. So you want to come with us, because that's what we're doing.
Prove your case, what the consequences?
Yeah, this is the deal. So we're going to hearing March 30th. This is the first hearing that we're going to. They have just been trying to dismiss our case time after time after time for a whole year, okay? And there are very little. The state law needs to be changed because these audits, even if you do find fraud like that, even in the state law, it says that it is, it's not going to change the results. So the audits don't even change the results, you guys. And that's for the whole state. That's for the whole state.
That's why I don't vote. Okay.
We want you to vote and have your vote counted correctly. Okay. Now this was Democratic Party fraud. This was Democratic Party fraud. Okay. And in the Democratic primary in March, it was Democratic Party fraud. 13 states, Washington D.C. and Puerto Rico, had very serious levels of election fraud in the Democratic primary. Bernie. A bunch of lawyers in Election Justice USA did the statistics, they went and they got affidavits from voters and they documented all of the fraud that the Democratic Party and their party operatives committed in the Democratic primary against Bernie in favor of Hillary, okay? And I'm gonna get to that. We're going to go through, right here. Democracy Lost. Democracy Lost by Election Justice USA is a 100-page report on all of the Democratic Party fraud. This was a surprise to us because most of the election fraud, massive election fraud that's occurred in this country prior to this time has been on the part of Republican operatives and Republican Party. And that's what this book chronicles. Code Red is about how the Republicans have been ripping it state after state after state. And so at this time, the Democrats did it. And that's the report. And you can just Google that report and read up about it. It really is a
very, very succinct chronicle of how they're doing it now. You know, they're doing it on the election machines. They're doing it at the central tabulators. They're kicking people off the rolls. There was a lot of voter registration hanky-panky in the Democratic primary. So we are now, what we're doing is the Cook County and Chicago are getting a whole new election system, and we're going in and we're trying to affect their choice of what they're going to buy. And we want to see if we can't get at least a hand count of a large percentage of our votes on election night before the ballots get centralized. And by centralized, meaning down into the Chicago Board of Elections warehouse, into the bowels of the political operatives where they can start throwing ballots out and, you know, creating havoc. So that is what our working group is doing, okay? And if you want to join us, you can send me an email or you can message us at Facebook on Who's Counting Chicago. And we're doing it quite quickly because on April 13th and 14th, the Chicago board is going to have this vendor fair with all the election systems, and they're going to invite the city council and the Cook County Board commissioners to come in and look at all these new election systems. And we want to be there with a bunch of highly trained people with a lot of information. We're getting a lot of information, and we want to be asking the city council, talking to the city council, talking to the Cook County Board, and really, really pushing the more verifiable counts that we're putting together, okay? I'd like to outline what that is, but we're still working on it. We're still working on it. We thought we had until May to do this, and they kind of pushed it up. So we are meeting pretty regularly every 2 weeks, and we're doing a lot of research. And we would really welcome people who have a computer science background, for sure, to join us. I think I am going to stop there, but I do want to remind you about what Joseph Stalin said. The people who cast the votes don't decide an election. The people who count the votes do. So I'd like to open it up to questions. I didn't go through all of my...
The top button.
Okay. Great.
There we go.
And, okay, go ahead.
Okay.
I was an Army technician. I worked for the Army. I learned a lot about Army equipment, but I left that a long time ago. I don't know the technology of it is about this digital thing.
Right.
But I understand the concept.
Right.
It's a flow of current, and you tap to it. It's simple as that. But I was trusting this system, the digital system, would be foolproof. But now...
Don't do it.
I don't know. What I'm saying, you know, going over there, making it more complicated, there's always a way to dig into and to, you know, to hack it.
Yeah.
But it cannot be made. Those people that are professional like yourself, it's cannot be made foolproof.
If I was the clerk of the Chicago Board of Elections, you better believe we'd have a foolproof, very transparent, very observable. One of the principles we're going on is that it's observable by the citizens, okay? And some of the machines now, when you put the paper ballots through the machine, it actually takes a picture of it, okay? And we're trying to figure out how to make sure that picture is not tampered with. And then maybe we can get all of those ballots, all those pictures, up on a website so everybody can count the votes.
But man, you know,
next question.
It's easy enough to make it foolproof if you move it this way,
no,
or move it that way.
There is no foolproof.
I say it could be made foolproof. Okay, I know that. I know enough about it.
Let me tell you. Okay, the Dutch went to paper ballots hand counts for a reason. Okay, they were like, whoa, yeah, we might get hacked by the Russians or whoever. We're going to go to paper ballots hand counts. Paper ballots are very, they are sturdy, and they can survive hand counts. Can you ask him to be, can you please be quiet a little bit?
All right.
Yeah, you're disrupting the rest of the room.
All right, nobody's complaining.
Okay, I am.
All right.
Okay, so the paper ballots are sturdy and they survive hand counts. And the voters like paper ballots. David Orr says that more people vote on the touchscreen machines out in the suburbs. But in the city, the paper ballots are chosen far greater. Hold on.
But the paper ballots are more defective.
This is the deal, is that no, they're not that defective. And what we're doing, what we're going to do, let me finish answering the question. What we're doing right now is we're going and we are talking to election integrity activists across the country. What are they doing in LA? What are they doing in San Francisco? All of these places are trying new things, okay? Some of them are open source software, okay? Some of them, there is no 100% foolproof voting, method. There's no question about that. Even in Canada, where they count most of their ballots by hand for their presidential election, even in Canada, way up in the moose country, in one election, some crazy guy, they were counting the ballots and they were taking the ballot box and they were dumping it over, and some crazy guy ran through, grabbed the whole ballot box and jumped in the lake. And they had to give it the whole town to come back and vote, okay, again. So no place, no thing is 100% foolproof. But we do have principles, and that is, you shouldn't be relying on the Board of Elections saying, oh, trust us, we counted it all correctly. Just trust us. That is not going to work anymore, okay? We're going to have to see that they're counting our ballots. We're going to have to be able to watch it and observe it. That's for sure, one principle, okay? There's also computer principles that are very, very important, like encryption. And like, the types of transmission. So there are lots of things to think about while we're coming into this process and making recommendations. They will not buy the system. Cook County and Chicago buy their system together. And the money comes from the City of Chicago, the City Council, and the County Board. And they will not buy anything until probably mid-summer or late summer. Okay. So we have plenty of time to go in there and really advocate. But now's the time. Now's the time to try to get a 25% hand count of the paper ballots the night of the election in central, in central spots, in the central receiving spots, something like that. We want to, for sure, the audits that are done 3 weeks after the election, that are done in this sham way, are not proving anything. They might as well not even have an audit. We didn't see any evidence that they were actually counting the votes correctly. None. So that much for sure. And we certainly cannot tolerate an audit of our votes that doesn't, if we find something different, that doesn't affect any change. Doesn't, it just doesn't matter. It literally is written in the law that it doesn't change the vote.
Yeah. Aren't there laws against this kind of fraud, and can't the people who are responsible for going along with it be prosecuted?
Yeah.
Or civil suits, perhaps.
Okay, so we have a civil suit. And I want you to know, we also went to the Department of Justice, the FBI, the Attorney General's office, and the State's Attorney's office, and the Inspector General of both the county and the city, and they didn't do anything. Nothing. And the ACLU. We went to the ACLU too. So they didn't do anything. Now, one of the things that we have done in this process is we started sitting down with Kim Fox and talking to her, because Anita Alvarez would not prosecute election fraud at all. And she was still on duty for the primaries. Okay? We went to her many times with very serious election fraud, and nothing from Anita Alvarez. So she just bowed to Madigan, and she wouldn't do squat. But Kim Fox says that she's going to be more responsive to election fraud. She took office after the general election. It was a couple weeks after the general election, so she was not on duty at the general election when we went in and saw that audit as well. So we would like to get an investigation and prosecution. I think what we're going to end up doing is getting an indictment by civil, you know, civil suit. An indictment, you know, that they're committing unlawful audits. And that is why they're working so hard. Their lawyers are working. The Chicago Board of Elections hired a very high-powered law firm to fight us on this lawsuit. And, you know, we've this entire year, all we've done is just survive motion to dismiss it. So we're, you know, we're hanging in there. We're hanging in there. And we would like to definitely get a judgment.
So you guys have a good
Yeah, you can talk to me later. Yeah. We do have a good lawyer.
Questions only during this time if we can.
All right. Say I was a say I was running for like Algonquin Township Supervisor.
Okay.
And the votes are going against me in the general election. Who could I go get help from to change those votes?
Algonquin, I'm not so sure.
How about Cook County? How could I get help to change those votes?
You know, in David Orr's operation, we think that there is it's not quite as dark and dirty. Okay, in the corners of David Orr's suburban Cook County. Okay, but Chicago, talk to me later, and I'll tell you who to go to, who to slip the envelope of money to. So, so not everybody, not everybody that works at the Board of Elections at Cook County and Chicago are corrupt. Not everybody are. We actually have it narrowed down to a very few people. It's very highly compartmentalized. I don't know if anybody's been down there, but there's the like vote by mail group, okay? And they don't talk to the early voting people, okay? And the early voting people don't talk to the election day people. And it all, it's kept very separate. That's one thing that they do. And so we do, we think we know who's, you know, calling the shots. And everybody else is just doing their job. Just doing their job. Now, I do believe that some of the employees at the audit realized that they weren't counting the votes correctly. In fact, we know that. We know that. So, but we're not here to get, we're not here to crucify any low level, you know, because it was really every single employee that was there. So we really want to get to the top. We really want to get to the top. We want an elected clerk for the city of Chicago, an elected, okay? And we want a verifiable, observable election process that where the audits do matter, where they do, if we discover that the ballots aren't being counted correctly, then we want that we want an investigation to ensue and a full recount. And we don't have that here in Illinois for any election jurisdiction at all. Any more questions? Charles?
Yeah, it seems like you're putting a lot of emphasis on technology. But isn't voting administered by a number of individuals at a polling place?
Yeah.
And they haven't mentioned who does this.
Yeah, okay, so let me talk about the election judges. So remember, in Chicago, we have over 2,000 precincts. And in Cook County, we have 1,600 precincts, suburban Cook County. So there's a shitload of judges on election day. Between 4 and 5 in each precinct. Now those judges are, some of them are well trained, but lots of them are not. And lots of them are patronage jobs. The alderman and the committeemen and the town supervisor gets to pick some of these election judges. We want that to stop too. We want to do away with the patronage situation. We do. Sorry, but we do. We want a test to all of the election judges, and if they can't pass the test, then they can't be an election judge. And it really makes a difference. In Chicago, some of the precincts, at the end of the day, you have to count the paper ballots, and you have to determine how many paper ballots were used, how many paper ballots were left over. So we can't even get good counts of that in some of the election precincts. So, go ahead.
Why?
You've already had a question. Next up.
I'm gonna have a lot of people here.
Go ahead.
What is it? What is it?
Go ahead, but quick, okay? Quick, yeah.
Why so many variable men? I'm mad about that. Why so many variable? What the hell I care who's the judge, who's not? If the system of counting is almost perfect, then no matter who is the judge, no matter if
it... It doesn't matter.
You can have a parallel system, for instance, a paper and an electronic, and we pass them on fast enough so we know it's something, it's a discrepancy in there. Why do...
judges
we can have a judge elected or not, man.
Judges do make
What I'm saying, for me, will make no difference. Will make no difference because those judges will be influenced by this, for this side or that side.
Okay. I'm going to repeat what the problem is, okay? So on election day, there are, 3,600 precincts in Cook County out there all over the place. And people are coming in and trying to vote. The judges make a big difference. They can keep voters from voting.
Yeah.
Sorry, you're not on the voting rolls, okay? Do you want to know what some judges did in a couple precincts in one of the aldermanic election a couple of years ago? You remember that we have to make the little arrow? We got to connect the little arrow with the black pens? They had a bunch of pens that had invisible ink. And they said to the voters, don't worry, it'll show up when you put it through the machine. The machine was an optical scanner that just picks up mark or no mark, okay? And, hundreds of people showed up and they didn't vote certain races. And it was, they were working on behalf of probably an alderman in the precincts that he didn't think he was going to carry. Okay? So yes, election judges do matter. They do matter, okay? So there's a lot, this is a really, really, unwieldy sort of thing. So one of the things that some jurisdictions are talking about are going to voting centers. Instead of having precincts all over the place like that, they want, here in Chicago, we would have a voting center in every ward. And if they would, instead of using the money for all those election judges, they would go and, have a transport bus going around the neighborhoods, getting people to come to the voting center. And the voting center would have a lot of, judges and equipment, but not as many as, hundreds. And they would all be well-trained. They would all be well-trained and observed. No campaign in the world can have observers in 3,600 precincts around the city. They can't, okay? As a poll watcher, I've been a poll watcher for every single election since 2003, and I typically cover 20, 30 precincts on election day. And I have seen so much. I have seen ballot stuffing in the boxes in the morning before they even open. So that was an election judge, okay, where, I said, oh, let me look in the box, and there's some ballots there already before the polls are open. I've seen pre-filled in ballots where they already got the choices already marked, okay? And some of the voters discover it and they say, hey, look, my ballot's already printed, been filled out, and they return it. And some of the voters don't, especially if they're doing it just on one race. Okay.
Well, thank you for your job.
It's not a job. I'm doing it for free.
No.
Okay? No. This is what democracy is about.
No. Pardon me.
Okay.
Okay,
let's get an opinion. How many people here think that democracy can flow fully and totally verifiable without citizen involvement? How many people here think that citizens are not the final, judge, the final observers of this? I'm telling you, we are. You okay.
Yeah, leave government up to professionals.
Oh, okay.
Right. Right.
Some Jamoku shows up.
That's called the Republic.
Well, that's how we got here.
Republic.
Yeah.
We're not a democracy.
This is how we got here.
We're not a democracy, we're a republic.
Okay, hey, republic. I'm just talking about the democracy about voting. So this is how we got here. Code Red, where they have flipped elections in jurisdiction after jurisdiction towards the Republican. That's what Code Red is all about, the red shift, okay? Why do you think that the Republicans control Congress, control the presidency, control the state houses, control the governors in so many states across this country, when poll after poll after poll show that the American people are far more progressive than their elected officials. Why do you think that is happening?
Because the regular voters don't show up at the polls.
That I will tell you, there's only two reasons, and it's this election fraud and gerrymandering. That's it. That's it. And I'm so sorry, there's one more. Money in politics. The massive money in politics.
Well, shouldn't she be a landed landowner to vote anyway?
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Well, the rest of us want democracy, and I'm going to have a sign-up sheet if you guys want to sign up. If anybody wants to sign up to join our group, we are a working group. We are a working group, so we don't sign up just to sit and listen. We are doing research, and we are really, really trying to figure this out. And there are really, literally, hundreds and thousands of election integrity activists around the country that are trying to figure this out. They are having a full reform processes in LA and San Francisco and many, many cities in California, and also New York. We did get indictments of some of the election fraud in the Democratic primary. There was a clerk in Brooklyn, a Democratic clerk in Brooklyn that purged 120,000 Bernie supporters off the rolls in New York. And she has gotten indicted. She has gotten indicted. So we got one going on. And there's been a couple other investigations. And there's been lots of lawsuits. Lots of lawsuits. And we have had judgments that the election clerks and the election officials are committing fraud.
We're not claiming the power of the people. This is for the people.
Yes.
Why you mentioned powerful lawyers. Who's the powerful lawyer? The law is the power, not the lawyer.
Okay. All right, all right.
I don't know how to have a lawsuit without
Neil's
a lawyer.
Neil's got a question.
Neil's got a question.
Will you please end the side conversation?
Okay, it's fine.
What? Thank you.
What?
You want me to be out of here?
I just want you to shut up.
Wait. No, you're shut up.
Okay.
Yeah, leave it up to the people.
We'll leave it up to the people.
One more guy, one fool at a time. No, he goes first.
All right.
Yeah.
See what you got.
Yeah, you talked about Cook County and Chicago from your own experience. You said the book, The Red, I forget the name of the red,
but
that represents to you probably pretty accurate about the United States.
Yeah.
Have you heard of or read other countries? You said Netherlands, but are there some countries that have very, very clean elections from your experience or reading?
Right.
Russia does.
So Ireland got rid of their electronic machines and they went to paper ballots and hand counts. And the German High Court, the Supreme Court, threw out all of the electronic machines in Germany and they're back to paper ballots, hand counts too. Yes. So, and there are many, many countries never went to the machines. Okay, but those are at least some that have gone from the machines where, you know, you can't tell what it's counting, right? You have to be a software specialist to know if it's counting correctly or not. So they said it was antithesis to democracy. Okay. So they've thrown them out. And many countries are voting on paper and counting by hand. Now, can we count every single ballot by hand? I would like to do that, but I don't know. We're still working on our real recommendations. It will have to do with cost too, right? So that's what this working group is going through. And there are some counties that do it here in America. Columbia County in New York counts by, they have two things. They have machines and they have a hand count. And what they do is they run it through the machine at night, and during the night they count them by hand. So they get the, you know, send the media the results, but they do a full hand count of most of the races during the next 2 days.
I mean, why not just put a $5 poll tax on to pay for the election?
Charlie would be the last call.
Charlie,
Laura, the example you gave, it would occur to me that electronic methods of voting are more accurate than the manual. You said you just went through the whole thing, and the manual process, you said none of it was accurate. So
okay.
I would say if manual's totally inaccurate, then you'd want to go to some sort of mechanical
okay,
process.
I understand your confusion. So what they were counting, remember the paper ballots at the audit, they don't count those by hand. Those are easy. You know, there's a dot for Bernie, there's a dot for Hillary, there's a dot for Trump.
Apart from
okay?
the precise
right.
process.
Right.
You
so,
had a manual system.
Can I answer the question, Charles?
Didn't work.
I'm going to answer your question. So those paper ballots, they just ran them through another machine. What they were counting by hand were these big toilet rolls. They literally are, can you put your hands up like this? They're like that. They're this round roll. And it's got like 400 votes printed on it, but not really clear. And you have to unroll this thing to count. And all the votes, so one person's total ballot is about like that big, okay? So they're printed kind of small. And it's hot, it's easy to miss. It's easy to roll past a vote, okay? That is what they were hand counting, that they could not get right. And it's called the paper trail of a touchscreen machine. It wasn't a paper ballot. Paper ballots are easy, okay? You can, a lot of people, when they do hand counts, they do what's called sort and stack. They take all the ballots and they sort them out. Bernie, Hillary, Trump, Cruz, okay? And they make piles of them and then they count them. That's for one race. And then they sort them again, okay? It's called sort and stack. It's a type of hand count. And so there are mechanisms for hand counting that are highly verifiable and very accurate. And there are some. Go ahead.
I seem to recollect if you counted, there probably were 100 candidates running for office last night.
Right. Exactly.
So all the elections are important.
I totally understand that.
Dog gets your electricity.
Okay, so here's what our recommendation is, because a lot of times it's the scare as well. Okay, it's the threat that you will find out. So one of the things that we're discussing is, because I do know that would take a long time to count. We had two ballots in the last election, and some were judges and things like that. So one of the proposals that we're considering is that we would go in, there's central receiving. When on election night, all the stuff comes in to, in Chicago, there's 7 central receiving areas. So all of the ballots and all of the blue carts and everything are being brought into these central receiving areas. And in suburban Cook County, I believe it's like 17 central receiving areas. And I think we might think about proposing that we're going to hand count at those central receiving areas. And we will take, we'll pick by random that night of the election, by random, races to count, okay? So that we can work through the night and get through all of these paper ballots. Or maybe we'll pick out 25%, 1 out of every 4 ballots. That might be it is a statistical sampling of most races, so that might be a good happy medium. So we're looking at these different possibilities. 100% hand count would take a long time. There's no question about it. And so even like Columbia, New York, they do a modified 100% hand count. And what it is that any race that is contested, they hand count. But if it's not contested, if somebody won by 80%, or if there's no no challengers in a race, they don't hand count those. So even they try to diminish, the time spent and the money spent. But it can be done.
Let's go to rebuttals.
That's it all, folks. That's
Let's
all.
Go to give rebuttals. Let's give a round of applause, Dr. Laura Hand. Yes. Okay.
How many people want to give a rebuttal tonight? And keep your hands up because I'm going to count them.
What do you want me to do with
1,
this, Tim?
2.
I'm going to take that off your hands in a second.
7, 8.
Once we get
9,
the timer started, And we hopefully tonight there won't be any cheating on the time.
We'll keep everything counted and accountable tonight. Everybody gets 4 minutes, no more. And it, well, yeah, we're going to have to have 4 minutes all the way to the end. If you get 10 people up here.
All right.
It's going to be 4 minutes apiece or less. If you can wrap it up.
We have a publicly available timer, so no fraud can be committed. So time theft won't be a problem.
We have two timers on.
Well, all right, gentlemen, let's get started.
Who's first?
Let's get started.
I have to take notes.
All right. Let's give another hand for Dr. Laura. You never told us if you were a Cubs or Sox fan, though.
I can't be honest. Dr. Laura Chamberlain has given us very great service here by bringing us her experiences and this information about how the audit is really not really much of an audit at all. Now, I had an experience when I went up, I was asked by the Hillary Clinton campaign, and I went up with a friend of mine to Racine County in Wisconsin, where a recount was being observed, Hillary was not very aggressive, shall we say, about really trying to get at this thing, because at that time in Racine County, my experience was that they didn't bother with, as we were talking about, a hand count of these ballots, and these were optically scanned ballots in the precincts that I observed, and they were the kind where you draw a line with a pen between two arrows, similar to the kind of things that we've seen off and on in Illinois. But they did not bother to do those hand counts of counting by hand to verify that the optical machine was counting correctly. They just put them through. And I, at one point, did try to do hash marks as they were putting them through very quickly, and even though I kind of had thought I got a little bit of a repartee with the people, and they were maybe going to go a little slower, they really didn't. So I was unable to verify that the by eyeball and hand counting that you could verify the optical machines were counting correctly. I also want to bring out that there was a study that was done. It was reported. A group from the, I think it was a Pennsylvania University, that they did a study of Wisconsin, and they found a 7% discrepancy in the counts. It was a statistical discrepancy in the counts in some counties. And I haven't had a chance to try and look that up. I wrote down the original person that was on the study in another notebook, so I can't give it to you, but it was a possibility of some hacking, let's put it that way. But it's disturbing that it was in Wisconsin, because Wisconsin went by such a very narrow margin for Trump.
Thanks, Dr. Laura Chamberlain, for a great talk.
Sorry.
I'll have to try to read that book among all the other books I'm trying to read. I believe in a free and responsible search for truth and meaning. If you're you know that's our fourth principle. And there is nothing against being a patriot, but our patriotism seems to be based on our history that is celebratory rather than accurate. I think we've got to redefine these things, because in a lot of ways we've got a great country, but we have so many weaknesses. We ought to look to other countries and try to get to truth, rather than just papering everything over with a sick kind of irresponsible definition of patriotism. Thank you.
I'm not very patriotic. How many people have seen the movie Hidden Figures about the computers at NASA? I was hit especially hard about halfway through.
It's an interesting, one of the interesting things about the movie is there are no spoilers. You can't, I mean, if you talk about the movie, you're not going to spoil it for anyone. There's a scene about halfway through where they're bringing in an IBM mainframe computer, and they have to smash out some wall because the door isn't big enough. And I was physically struck by that scene because the IBM 7090 was my first computer and Fortran was my first language. It was a couple of years, about three, 4 years later than the movie. So I've been messing with that stuff for quite a while. I could really summarize the situation with regards to electronic voting very briefly and simply. There is no such thing as secure electronic voting, period. That's all. Anybody who tells you otherwise is either ignorant, lying, or something else unflattering. I would like to add a couple of small bits. The word hack has been used a lot, and it's kind of ambiguous. Most broadly, a hack is a clever improvisation or workaround in some technical endeavor. In programming, it's a really slick bit of code. Also, it's used in a sort of a geeky, nerdy one-upmanship that I can pick your lock better than you can design a lock, and I can get in where I'm not supposed to go. And originally, hacking was talking about simply penetrating computer systems. More recently, it's possible to do that for financial gain, so you get your black hat hackers. But basically, hacking is unauthorized access. So for example, if the database was hacked, that just means that somebody read stuff they weren't supposed to be able to get to. It doesn't necessarily mean that the voting process was corrupted. If anything, it was either somebody goofing off just to show they could do it, or it was commercial for personnel identity theft. It probably had nothing directly to do with throwing elections. And you mentioned large-scale widespread isn't going on. That's only because the system is not centralized enough. She talked a little about a system called CrossCheck, which matches names in different states to find people who supposedly have moved and registered in their new state, but their registration in the old state hasn't been canceled yet, so hypothetically they could cast an extra vote in their old home. But in real life, CrossCheck was a Republican gimmick for throwing out tens of thousands of Democratic registrations. And most of the matches actually were not real matches. It was John T. Smith here and John Q. Smith there, so we'll strike them both because they live in, you know, black inner city neighborhoods and probably vote Democratic. That cross-check was bogus. But on the other hand, one of the major manufacturers of voting machines, Diebold, I think, Diebold, is owned by a major Republican backer. Nudge, nudge, wink, wink.
With all that due respect, Doctor, and I thank you for your interesting talk, I'm amazed at the fact that any of this stuff is news to you. The Democratic Party, and here in Cook County and here in Chicago, has been doing this kind of stuff since the 1950s, since I was an infant. In the old days, it involved moving the polling places on the night before the election.
Yeah.
Or it involved doing various things with the old-fashioned voting machines. Or you spoke of paper ballots. They are not an end-all and a be-all. You understand what an enterprising precinct captain can do with a paper ballot?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, I do.
So this kind of stuff isn't new. And even in relatively recent years, polling places have opened with the election judges already three sheets to the wind. Or a few years ago, an election judge was busted, not for doing anything wrong in the polling place, but because during his lunch hour, he boosted a bunch of crackers from a nearby store. So this kind of stuff isn't new. And there's a part of me that would like to see the laws loosened so that you could vote more than once, so that dead people could vote, and all the rest of this stuff. I mean, the Republicans get away with this, so why shouldn't we? Thank you.
All right.
Yeah, I'm Dan Bader, and I'm going to give a brief update. Oh, by the way, thank you, Laura. Good presentation. So I'm going to give you a little climate news update, as I've been doing. It's pretty clear that Donald Trump is going to shut down the availability of data on climate change. You know, he's making all of these cuts in departments which actually could produce the data if they were given a green light. So you're going to lose your access to data. And as I stated, I think it was last week, if you want to follow the data, that's really the only way you can keep track of what you're looking at. So Arctic News is a very good website for looking at data. And the scientists who participate there are pretty bold in terms of what they say. So you can all look at that. But access to data is being shut down very quickly by Trump. And you know, and you have to be a realist about Donald Trump. You know, he himself is very ignorant about climate change. That's not a surprise. I mean, most people are. And so he gets his information from academics who are essentially being paid by the energy industry, and from university departments that are essentially subsidized by the energy industry. So Donald Trump and a lot of other people, they just listen to it. Oh, this is not happening, this isn't a problem, etc., etc. And you know, once somebody gets a belief, it's very, very hard for them to let it go. The other thing that you should be aware of, I believe, is that the government essentially is drawn probably a correct conclusion that most of the population could not handle some really dire news about the climate, that it would be a little bit too much. You know, I think I related here one time when I first got clued into the potential of, you know, the exponential change and the consequences of it. And I was listening to this scientist and this journalist who were talking on the Real News Network, and they basically said, you know, we could be looking at extinction very shortly down the road. And I was not really able to take that in, even though intellectually I understood what they were saying. Emotionally, I couldn't take it in. And I think most of us share that belief that we all have to die as individuals, but not as a species or a group. So it's a very difficult area. A number of scientists who do understand what's probably coming believe that geoengineering interventions of various kinds could work. But people need to become aware as individuals. Last thing I want to say is, if you're a young person in your late teens, 20s, or 30s, you probably ought to watch the data for about 2 or 3 years. That's all it's going to take for you to understand what is coming or not coming. And you may not want to, you know, have a child during that time period, because it would be quite painful to have to go through that. So thank you very much, and I'll keep you updated.
All right, Jonathan.
Thank you very much, Dr. Laura, for an excellent talk. It's never been easier to murder a child in history. As we saw last week, a place of faith was bombed where there were children. It doesn't matter whether it was a Christian or Jewish or Sikh or Muslim or a Buddhist place of faith. It was a place of faith where there are children. That's murder.
That's worse than treason. It's a crime against humanity, and it's never been harder to vote for honest people in the country that commits the most murder. In 2000, then-candidate Bush proclaimed that he was going to restore honor and integrity to the White House of the United States of America. 2008, then-candidate Barack Obama said he was going to tell us what we need to hear, or what we need to know, not what we want to hear. In 2016, then-candidate Trump said the system is rigged, and he was going to make America, quote, great again. It sounds like a testimony. I don't even need the mic tonight. It sounds like a testimony of criminals when they know a jury of 7 billion people are about to finish their deliberations and say, we have nothing personal against you. What were some of the comments? I forget. Hold on, I got it. Have you had experience before, or maybe something went wrong? What was that election judge's comments? Do you remember that?
The election judge is where?
Yeah, in the video on Lee Camp Redacted Tonight. What did they say again? Have you had
experience
before? These right. problems have happened before. Sometimes right. things happen.
Right.
Sometimes things happen. Yeah. When we financially make you walk the plank, and you know who you are, watching us through that camera on the web. When we occupationally make you walk the plank. When we legally make you walk the plank, and I'm a Unitarian Universalist too, Gene, so I don't want them to physically walk the plank. It would make my day to see them in the International Criminal Court, the court that they make laws to prevent themselves from ever being in that court, and have life in jail. Because we're civilized. We don't stoop to your level. We don't kill children in places of worship and then call ourselves a God-fearing nation. We don't prevent people who are the most honest people in the history of this country, like Bernie Sanders or Jill Stein or Dennis Kucinich or Cynthia McKinney or Rosa Clemente or Ajama Baraka or Sherry Hankala.
Why are you shouting at us?
The bombs are much louder than I am. And when Slim Brundage talked in those days, they were a lot louder than this. Slim's ghost is with us all. Slim's spirit is with us all. I'm not being violently loud. I'm being
emphatically,
patriotically loud, to use their phrase. Because we have a Patriot Act since 2001. Does the Patriot Act not give them access to know whether we have fair counts of our elections? Does the National Defense Authorization Act not guarantee that we have 100% accuracy all the time on elections? It's the 23rd hour. The Greeks had the same problem. When everybody shows up, that's when the least amount of corruption happens, peacefully and democratically. Let's start showing up. 320 million people. All right. Thank you, Laura. That's a good time.
All right. Next.
What?
I'll talk to you
about July. Okay.
Give me a minute. Let's, all right. All right, 4 minutes.
I'm very much surprised, Miss, for all the information you give us. Thank you very much. I'm not a regular voter. I know Puerto Rico have a big problem with voting fraud. We know that. But I only can deduct that was copied from the Americans. They copy every trick, dirty trick from Americans. We know that. And over there, they do it more obvious than here. The politician over there, they take money from the druggies. Over here, I don't know how they do it, but they do it too. But I really thank you, but I'm very surprised at this. That's why I'm so excited talking. By the way, more respect to the lady, this gentleman here, I raised my hand. I'm not a dictator. I raised my hand and she allowed me to answer. It's not for anybody to block that conversation. And you gotta have more respect for the lady.
the lady was the one to allow me to talk. Not that I was doing it on my own. So I don't know if the gentleman here is the owner of the College of Complicity. Let me know so I don't come back again. But thank you very much. I still say that the voting should be almost foolproof. It's very simple. It's, I'm a good analyzer, you know. Counting ballots by hand and compare it with a machine. One by one, and that it, you will get a lot of volunteer for that, and it could be a better system. I know she's looking for ideas. I got plenty of ideas, but when you have a group of people, you see, the American people normally, what they do, I'm from Puerto Rico, I have a different angle to analyze things. See, what the American people do, they have a group of people, and the bigger mouth, that's the one everybody follow. It's the same like the court system, you know, many, the group of people, the judge and the jury, and even the big mouth is the one that picked for the captain, and then everybody rushing because they have to go back to work, and it's not a good decision. They have found a lot of people guilty when they're not. So the same thing, now the ladies have a group of people input, and maybe the bigger amount is the one that's gonna win. That's not a good way of finding a better system. A better system is something else. It's not a group of people invited to give their own opinion. That opinions are like 1 million per penny. So you gotta miss. I recommend you find a better way to find that better system. I'm sure you will find it. Thank you.
Okay. Next. All right. Next rebutter. We got an open mic.
We had 10 hands up tonight. Who else wants to give a rebuttal?
I'll go.
Somebody else who wanted to vote.
Go, Chuck. Go ahead, Charlie. All right.
I'm not allowed to yell, though. The guy gets excited. That's good. Young man's enthusiastic. All right, let's thank our speaker again very much. Clean Cook County here for trying to clean up. I'll be eclectic very quickly here. I've dabbled in and out of this voting thing. Democrats for America had a monthly conference calls, and I've been following some of the legislation that's been advanced in the 214th Congress, at least, regarding voting and registration. We're all concerned about going in to vote, and you vote for Joe, and then you find out the machine somehow, you're casting a vote for John, and there's some corrupt person who has corrupted the machinery and switches the votes around. I don't know how often that occurs, but it apparently has entered the intellect of the voters. I'm very much afraid that people won't vote because they think it's not being legitimately and accurately tallied. And that's the real danger of this, and why it's important that people have faith and confidence that their vote is important, and each vote is important, does matter. I approach it from another angle. Early in my life, I was director and over the years in charge of circulation in public libraries. I was director of circulation for the Philadelphia library system. So you have things, you have to check records, and tallies are things in a binary system. I can only tell you, and there's multitude of ways of checking records or maintaining records in this capacity. No manual system is better than an electronic one. they both require the same number of individuals to administer. But electronic will always win in terms of accuracy over a manual system. And I know that for a fact because my responsibility was to try to deal with the errors that occurred in a manual system. People were charged for materials under a manual system. So believe you me, I lived with that. I think there are ways to incorporate security features in your electronic system. Just coming to mind, it's not my area, would be duplication of records. Multiple copies would be one way to ensure that you could have retrieval later and review. You have incorporated electronics in the voting process. From it's a process that goes from registration to the final tally to removal from the rolls. It's a little hard to say we're going to have a system that's going to eliminate electronics altogether.
I'm
just glad, but anyhow, that's just some thoughts.
Well, the electronic says your time's up.
There's no one else. All right.
I don't want to break any rules. Anyhow, thanks a lot.
Okay.
Don't want to break any rules.
You know, there's a few ways that we could reform this election system to make it clean. You know, they do it, Russia usually runs a clean election. All you got to do is have one candidate on the ballot, and you don't have to worry about anything. Yes, like with Putin. They don't have problems with counting the votes with only one candidate. Second of all, you know, look how much money we have spent on the elections. They said it averaged out to like $38 per voter or $40-something dollars per voter by the time they put all the campaign money in and divided up all the money spent and what each vote was worth. Why not make it a truly representative democracy, put out on the internet and say, Hillary, I'll give you $50 to vote for me, or perhaps maybe I'll give you $75 for me, and we can eliminate the campaigning and just go right direct to the voter. You know, all the campaign funds direct to the voter. It might be a better way to help reform the system. Hell, I would have put my, if I got $75 for Hillary, I may have just cast my ballot. Thank you.
Yes, I did it in Cook County all the time.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm not a lefty.
That's okay. All right, Andy.
Start the clock.
Okay, we're set, dude.
I'm indebted to Professor David Ray Griffin for a quote that I use a lot. It describes the concept better than anything I have seen from anywhere else. In one of his early books, he said, "You don't need an open mind to understand this. You need a 30% open mind and a 7th grade education. 30 over 7. All you need is a 30% open mind, step through the psychological barrier and look at the evidence. And it's so easy to understand that if you graduated from 7th grade, you can understand it." Now, we have people walking around standing in a blizzard of evidence with college degrees, PhDs, claiming they can't understand what's going on. Well, when somebody with a college degree claims they can't understand something very simple, they're either insane or they're an intellectual prostitute. We have people, as several people have mentioned here, university professors paid to produce reports saying there's no global warming or cigarette smoking is not a health hazard. There's no problem with dealing with inhaling asbestos dust. We've had intellectual prostitutes in this country amplified by the media for a long time. And Project Censored out of Sonoma State University talks about this. They publish a book every year on the top 25 blacked out stories. And Barnes & Noble would not make that book available, which was published in October, until after the election this year. It was the first time, this was the 40th anniversary edition of Censored News, and I couldn't get any copies through Barnes & Noble until after the election was over. And they were unable to tell me why. They just had a glitch in the system. Well, what's in that book is a chapter about the deal that our corrupt media made with the Hillary Clinton campaign. Before they had the first primary, the media told Hillary, you do good things for us after you get elected and we will bury Bernie for you.
Yeah.
Nationwide, we will report Bernie is losing when he is winning the primaries, which is what they did. Bernie was the clear winner nationwide. You had no question about it. And the polls show today that even in Republican areas where people voted for Trump, Bernie is the most popular candidate among the person in the country among Trump voters. They understand. Another point. The only reason we have electronic voting machines, the only reason those machines are in existence is to shift votes toward a candidate that could not get elected otherwise. This country is not criminally insane Republican. Less than 20% of people will vote for these criminally insane candidates if you count the votes correctly. They have to redshift it after the polls close. 89 criminals in Congress, masquerading as our Congress critters, are still in office because they redshifted the vote in 2014. The newspapers say, how come we're not voting these people out? How can Americans be so stupid as voters? Well, we're not stupid as voters. We're voting these crazies out, and they're changing the vote totals after we go to bed. That's what we got. And as one scientist said, the Republicans have a big, big problem. The scientists have not figured out a way to help young Latino women give birth to old white racist men. The old white racist base of these criminals is dying out. And among people of between 18 and 30, about 70% of them list themselves as Bernie supporters right now, nationwide. So the first step in any of this is speaking the truth. Just simply speak the truth, learn what it is, open your mind, just 30%, that's all it takes, with an open mind, no prejudice, look at the evidence, and you'll be able to understand what's going on in many different ways. And somebody has been mentioning websites here. I still say Common Dreams and Truth Out are two of the very, very best for posting the best of the best news every day. Okay? Thank you. And Dr. Laura gets the last word.
Yes, Dr. Laura. All right.
We got one more.
You got one. Okay.
One more.
All right.
This is the last rebuttal.
It won't be long. Just two words. You know this business of the Russians interfering with our election? That's terrible. Ever since I heard about it, I couldn't sleep at night. Why doesn't somebody do something about it? And then I start comparing it, changing elections. What about sending Marines like to Guatemala and changing an elected government? Are you still feeling indignant? Or does that make us a little bit hypocritical? Maybe we should have changed the Guatemala government by a computer instead of Marines. It wouldn't be so bloody. This world is crazy. I can understand it. So that's about it.
Okay. Dr. Laura, last word.
I totally agree with you. I think that this is, I think it's a bit of karmic balancing. Because it's not just Guatemala, it's Iran and
Honduras
and El Salvador. And we've undermined elections around the world.
Ukraine.
Ukraine.
Cuba, Haiti.
So it is a little bit karmic balancing, but we are Americans, and gosh darn it, we believe in the truth and the light and democracy for everyone. Right? So I'm going to rebut. Wisconsin, in the recounts, for the recounts, absolutely, you know, there was a lot of talk about the recounts in Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. You really have to remember, in Pennsylvania, the recounts never occurred. They were sued, they were brought down, they were closed up, okay? In Michigan, they recounted just a few, just a handful of counties, and then they were sued, and it was closed up shop. So Pennsylvania was not recounted, Michigan was not recounted, and Wisconsin did not do a hand count. I believe it was 40% of the counties were hand counted in Wisconsin, all the rest were not. So there was no recount, really, in the presidential race. And those, all three of those states were very close, within 10,000. Here in Chicago, at the Democratic primary, we had visual evidence of possibly 20,000 votes just in Chicago flipped, okay? So 10,000 votes throughout a state is nothing, nothing. Easy to do. Okay, Arctic News, is he here? Okay, absolutely.
I'm here. Arctic
yeah.
News.
So we're already geoengineering. We're already geoengineering. Okay?
Chemtrails, right.
That's what those chemtrails are. They're trying to slow down global warming. It's not working. I totally agree with you about Arctic News. I totally agree with you about Truth Out and Common Dreams as well, for sure. And Neil, did you ever hear about the guy, Neil, did you ever hear about the guy that there was all this talk around 2001, and there was a guy who said that he was from the future. Do you remember this? He had a blog, and he was from the future, and he came back. We figured out time travel. He was an American. We figured out time travel, and he came back to America at that time, around 2000, to get some equipment for an IBM mainframe computer. Did you ever? You should poke around about this. When you said that, I was like, oh my God, this is so weird. And he talked about the U.S. going into a civil war. The rural U.S. versus the urban U.S. This guy from the future who blogged, you know, shortly after the year 2000. Now we're getting spooky. We're getting spooky, guys. Okay, number three. Thank you, unauthorized access, hacking. Okay, thanks for that. Diebold was owned by a Republican operative, and Smartmatic, another voting machine, is owned by a Democratic Soros operative.
Oh.
So they have their machines, voting machines, we have ours, okay? Okay, number two, it's not new to me. I don't know where the audience is, so I could really, really give this whole talk totally cynical. Like, they effed us again, everyone, you know? Are we ever gonna stand up for it? We gotta stop laughing about it, though. That's what most people do. When you talk to them about election fraud in Chicago, they start laughing. They go, oh, yeah. You know, the aldermen, they used to block the buses from coming from here or there. And, you know, they'd give them tickets and they'd have to. We got to stop laughing about it. These are our elections. We have to get more serious about it, right? Because they're ripping us not only just at the aldermen, not at the dog catcher, but also the presidential. Bernie should have walked into the Democratic National Committee convention with 9 more delegates than Hillary. And if they would have given it to Bernie, the future of our entire country would be different. This is really, really important stuff. So we just have to stop laughing about it, okay? That's all I beg you to do. So I totally know that the Democrats locally have been ripping it. The Democratic primary is the first time that we really knew that there was organized Democratic Party stealing of the elections over many states. 13 states, Washington, D.C., and Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico was stolen bad. Yeah. So democracy lost. It's not very hard to read this report. It's very good. How do they do it? Okay, wait a minute. Who wants us to be able to vote with money? Stop it! So everybody who has a lot of money gets a lot of votes, and everybody with not so much money, they don't get so many votes.
It's called. You get what you pay for.
Well, that's the way it is right now, and that's what we and this is what we have.
But you give, totally if it goes directly to the voter, you will eliminate the middleman.
So buy yourself a president, okay?
They already did that.
We're in the stages of terminal corruption here in America, and we need to move
away from
that.
We need hospice care.
We need hospice care, is right. The antidote to corruption is people power. There's no question about it. The voting is much more complex than you think it is, you guys. You got to have handicap access. The reason why we can't vote online is because you're not going to get a number for your vote so that nobody can track you down and say, why did you vote like that? Okay? That's the problem. With your bank account, you have a number. You're checking your, you can follow the trail. But with your ballot, if you can follow the trail, then somebody can follow the trail back to you. Okay? That's the real, real big problem. I'm going through this. Automatic voting registration. They passed another automatic voting registration bill in Springfield. Please call your rep and senator, your state rep and senator, for this bill. Okay? This is where people who go to the voter, to get a new driver's license, they will be, all they'd have to do is just check a box and they'd be automatically registered. If they go to get a vehicle license, automatically registered.
Like organ donation.
Yeah, right. So it's really, it's a good bill. They cleaned it up a lot. Please call your state rep and senator and say yes to automatic voting registration. Okay? And last but not least, it is very important that we have confidence in the system. This past presidential election was the largest no vote percentage in the last several decades. People do not think that their votes are being counted correctly. There's no question in my mind. So it's very important. This work that we're doing is extremely important. And we do want to get it right. And we want it to be as simple as possible, but there are some things that make it complicated, okay? And if you go to vote the next time and you have to put your little pinky in a little ink well like they do in Iraq, you'll know who to thank. Okay.
That's a good idea.
Exactly. Right. Let's have real democracy. Thank you.
All right, Dr. Laura.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Dr. Laura.
Thank you, Dr. Laura. And with that, the college is adjourned tonight. We'll see you next week.
Thank you.
Turn this off.
I'm Governor Gary Johnson. I'm running for
president. You knew that was good.
I'm running with him. As the governor of New Mexico, I vetoed wasteful spending 750 times, cut taxes 14 times, and left the state with